morning.
I love you. Merry Christmas to you all. Boy, I hope you really did have a Christ in your Christmas this holiday. It's important. It really is, guys. And boy, I love each and every one of you, the Christ that's in you. You know, I'm so thankful that God's placed that in your hearts. And boy, guys, man, it comes from the knowledge of Christmas. You know, it comes from the knowledge of the birth of that baby and all the different things that we've got to journey through in our lives using last week's message, you know, and stuff. And boy, it's just one of those things. You know, Jesus does change your situations in a like fashion. You know, last night I got a good opportunity to sit down and share with my father-in-law, you know, the difference between, you know, a child of God and Christians, in a sense, you might say. A lot of people claim to be Christians and all the different things. And boy, guys, it's a wonderful thing to claim. But as a child of God, you know, has a place to put those situations. You know, Brother Steve's class this morning. A child of God really has a place to put them, and that's in Jesus Christ, guys. That little bitty baby that came and lived a perfect life that we couldn't, you know. But anyhow, that's what that I was really explaining to him. And I said, and boy, to be a child of God, you have to keep that spirit infilled with the love of God. And that's the difference. There's a lot of good people out there, and there's a lot of good Christians out there. But the trouble is, if they don't keep God in their life, you know, and that's their focus, you know, sometimes, as Mike and I was talking earlier, sometimes just be silent and observe and the situation and the spirits and everything else. And the wonderful thing I heard out of that is there's a great peace in that, Butch, you know, and there really is. And I'm thankful for that. But that too, being good, guys, if it's good, it's God. You know, and that's really what it boils down to. So, boy, I hope that in all reality, we all had a good Christmas. And boy, we really get to see him that delivered. You know, today's message, I can't help it. I'm anxious as I can possibly be. And that's Christmas the next day. It could never have been more fitting than this particular Christmas this year, where we have a service the next day. You know, so Christmas the next day. And guys, it's an absolutely beautiful teaching. So, well, I love you all. Special prayer request this week, Michelle.
My sister-in-law, Sarah Brandon, she has got quite a bit of health issues. In fact, she's on one of those portable heart monitors now. And they're trying to figure out what's going on there.
She had passed out and broke her nose.
Oh my goodness.
And she was sitting at the kitchen table.
My mother passes out, but she's got her nose rested in her knees. And so she's protected at least. It's not to make fun, because that's not funny. But Tammy, honey.
Her mom, dad, and Jacob's salvation.
You bet. Tammy's family salvation. They will surprise us one day. The Lord has assured me of that. As they talk about it. But I really do appreciate the opportunities to be able to sit down and every opportunity to be able to share that love of God. They really think that I am a very peculiar person. They've not experienced anything like that in their life. You know, and so guys, it's, once again, it's not me. You know, I'll just tell you that, you know, it's really that Spirit of God in them, and salvation will come through our prayers, and salvation will come to their hearts. I'm absolutely certain of it. So guys, man, yes, definitely, always for our families. Anyone else? Jasmine?
Pray for my grandma Parkhart's present.
house ready for her to come back home. And she said that she's going to need it because my cousins are going to be
fighting her
all the way to get it sterilized so my aunt can come home to the hospital. She's staying there to help my aunt, so it's like, going to take care of her, but they're going to fight her every step of the way.
Yeah. So, I can stand against the Spirit of God.
That's why I asked for our request for prayers.
Donna.
Prayers lined up. I know your niece are going back from Virginia this morning. It just prayers that they, I know you, my niece, they're driving back home from Virginia. Just prayers that they have a safe trip home. It was so great to see them. I haven't seen them in 7 years. They don't get up there very often with 3 kids. And they're young kids, so they don't travel real well. Their one child, their oldest one, has
autism.
Yeah, he's very autistic and he's very, very challenged. But it was so great to see him. He's just come such a long way. They told me he'd never speak. They told me he wouldn't have to be, have a normal life. And he is, and it's just, thank you, God, it's amazing. He talks, he's doing so well.
Thank you, Lord.
It's amazing.
Thank you, Don. Also, guys, man, Brother Steve.
I was just going to say two things. One, Jim.
Yeah, definitely. Jim Hardaway down in Arizona had an accident with a chainsaw. I guess he found out that he wasn't that tough. But it did take a pretty good chunk out of his ankle to the point where it probably took it to the bone. You know, there's only a slim, one little accident's terrible with the chainsaw.
And the other thing is, pray their situation with their YouTube and everything is up and going.
Yes, going there too, guys. You know, as we, you know, we're fortunate enough to be able to get to watch the Mother Church on YouTube and stuff. I see the old hinderer trying to take place, but you know, there's so many other ways, you know. And you know, I thank God. You know, okay, so whatever you think you've done something there, but look, we're still spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ here. So. He's not victorious in any way, churches, but yes, we definitely want to lift our Mother Church up. We miss that fellowship every week with them. So yeah, Jim, all I can say to you is, dude, it looked like he was cutting wood with shorts on. Should know better. Tennis shoes and shorts.
We do have an update from Daddy Tracy. They're going to be starting their Monday night, hopefully in January. He said sometime in January they'll be starting their Monday night service.
Very good, guys. Boy, I've really tried to think about this situation because I think it's really important that we have those teachings as well. And with them being able to, God willing, get their YouTube back up and stuff, we will end up taking it and having the availability, if you're interested, on Monday nights to be able to come down and watch that. Now, the difference is we're going to have to be a week behind. And the week reason for that is because when they start, it would make it about midnight when we got done if we did it watching it live. So what we'll do is we'll run that a week behind, God willing, just so that, you know, we could all have a part of that. I know it'll be instrumental in your walk with Christ. And, you know, it's from those very teachings that I myself have had the background and the solid foundation to be able to build on. And I think it's important. So, boy, guys, if you have ears to hear, let the Spirit speak. You know, come and be a partaker of that. Anyone else, special prayer requests? I do have one for myself, and boy, Betty, honey, man, I just, before this body, as well as the heavenly host itself, man, I just ask you to accept my apology for Christmas. My goodness, with all the stuff, Beauty, I really did not mean to forget you at all, and I really do ask you forgiveness, and I want you all to know that, you know, it really hurts me that I slipped. You know, in that aspect, I try not to slip, you know, so to speak. But I guess God tells me right off, anytime you know that's happened, get back to Him as quickly as you can and ask for that forgiveness. You know I'm supposed to ask it in private, but you know, I'm the pastor, I'm coming straight to you. I'm bringing it before the church. So,
you know you're forgiven.
I know, baby, but
I'm sure we're thinking about me as I was thinking about you. Oh, always.
Yes, and so anyhow, and any of you viewing that, boy, you know, I slipped. Please don't take it that way. Boy, let us just rejoice in our Father and boy, His Spirit. Thank you, Betty, for that. Thank you, Lord. Is there anything else? Any birthdays this week? Anniversaries? None of them either? Come on.
Just Christ's birthday.
What's that?
Just Christ's birthday that came.
It is Christ's birthday. Yes, it is, you know. And so that's why we're going to have Christmas the next day. So, well, guys, I love you so very much. I thank each and every one of you. Boy, Sister Jasmine, what do you got for us this week?
All right, first got to readjust the camera. And we're going to, please stand, and we're going to sing When We All Get to Heaven.
When We All Get to Heaven.
I got to readjust the camera. Let us go to the Father, please, for this offertorial prayer. Brother Dwayne, would you lead us, please?
Dear Lord, bless these tithes and offerings, heal those that are on prayerless, Father, and bring those who can't make it here this morning back onto us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Including the TV and everything like that, because they would like to see how everyone can be. So I'm like, well, God willing, once we get the internet, we do the live streaming, I'll have to move back because
that's why she's not coming.
be allowed each year, because last night when we were talking with our family members, especially Kendra and her husband, they were like, everyone's like, oh, it's a lot clearer. And I was like, yeah, because the phone is closer, but once we get our camera, our webcam here, that will pick up.
When are they doing the internet?
Wednesday. They're supposed to be coming Wednesday, God willing.
So I'm hopefully late.
Yes. Me and Butch and I were thinking about being here from 8 to 10. I think they're going to leave, and if they don't show up, we need 10 on here. From 10 to 12.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus, he came to love, forgive and heal, he lived and died to buy my forgive me. Still not there. So sorry. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds a future and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll see this victory, and Christ will bring his message free. And then I'll sing his glory forever, and we will all be there the day Christ is real. Because he's real, I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet it is to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can place in certain days because he I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds a future and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and then I'll know he reigns. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds the future and Christ is worth the living just because he lives. Well, that's just to show you that I'm still the same old guy. It's good. I run into them things just like anybody else in their days, you know, guys, and I really don't like it, but it is what it is, and you know what? There's a day that all that stuff will be passed away, and I'll surrender that all in my victory in Jesus Christ. So, well, I guess I love you so much. You know, it's all about those different things and wanting to bring, you know, the best news to all of humanity that I can possibly do. And guys, listen, it really is hard to try to keep everything focused on the spirit and all that, and then trying to sing and all the other different things. There's a lot of things changing right now, and I can't help it. You're going to have to put up with me. What's that?
Give it to God.
Give it to God. That's right. Today, our message, guys, masterful message. I just thank the Spirit so much for giving it to me. The reality of following up there in Luke chapter 2, verse 20, coming right out from last week about the journey, you know, it's the very same thing. But the title this week, Christmas the Next Day. You know, and one of the things that I really do love so much about Christmas is so many people's attention is focused on Christ, or so it's supposed to be. You know, and people come from far and wide to celebrate Christmas, as you know, we see throughout, you know, different places. And there's a lot of traveling going on, or in last week's message, there was a journeys going on. You know, and people who had never attended church ever before in their life, for whatever reason, it always seems that they'll make, you know, those services at a Christmas time. And I'll take that opportunity, every one of you know, man, I'll take that opportunity. You know, maybe Christmas was something like we've seen right there in our scriptures out of Luke last week. You know, maybe it was a lot just like that, you know. They had angels singing back at the very birth of Jesus Christ, you know. And you know, it's kind of like, you know, the air's filled with Christmas music. The angels were singing, and boy, they were singing, and it was filled with Christmas music back then. And they had shepherds that visited, you know, kind of like a local friend or people around us dropping by at Christmas time. And not only that, that they had wise men that came from out of town. You know, many of us, you know, they didn't make it in time for Christmas. If you read the story, the wise men didn't make it in time for Christmas, but they got there, and they got there for the same reason. They really did. It's kind of like when we go around to our families in other cities. You know, sometimes we just can't get there on Christmas. But we show up, you know, that very moment at that right time of that year, you know. But let me point out something to you, church. Let me point something out to you, a little note. Luke, in chapter 2, verse 20, he records for us something. That after the shepherds had visited the baby, after they had visited, the shepherds returned. And that's a fact. In fact, if you think about it, most everybody, even right now, you know, they go right back to life, normal, the same as it was before that first day of Christmas. So many people, the next day, Christmas is over, yesterday, all that celebration, all that stuff, we're gathering up, we're getting ready to leave, we're going back, you know. And the sad thing in my heart, really it is, church, as your pastor, the sad thing in my heart is that so many people come that close to Jesus, and then the next day, they just turn and they return back to their same old lives, the same as it always has been. Really missing the gift of Christmas, really missing the very love that God had introduced to them at that particular time in their life. Everything else, and it seems to be that opportunity. Shepherds returned to their flocks. The angels silenced their singing. The wise men made their long trip back home. And it seems like everybody forgot about that holy night. And it happens. It happens a lot, even in our days. So much so that we don't even know for sure what day Christ was actually born on. We really don't know. You know, the shepherds returned as did everyone else, but there was ones that did not, and that was Mary and Joseph. See, Mary and Joseph, when Christmas was over, you know, they simply returned, most of us just simply returned to our normal life, perhaps even praising God, perhaps, you know, even a chance of celebrating, thanking God to be able to celebrate Christmas. We really should be thankful that we're able to celebrate Christmas, guys. But really, none the different than you were just before. You've got to see Jesus and celebrate. But like Mary and Joseph, we have lives that radically change. And they radically change right here at Christmas time. You know, all of us that's ever had children, well, we know that at the birth of a baby, it changes our lives forever. It really does. You know, a person can never be the same after having a child born unto their family. They really can't. And while when the baby is born, many people come and they see the baby and the little child, they visit in the hospitals, they bring some flowers perhaps, or maybe even a small gift or a hug, a cuddle in the little guy or little gal for a minute or two. Only the parents come away from being totally changed at birth. And I was just wondering this morning, church viewers, I was just wondering this morning, when we consider our visit with Christ this Christmas, I really was wondering, will we come away with more than those who stopped by for a few minutes? It's a really good question. whether you're viewing or whether you're sitting right here, it's a very good question. Well, you know, will you come away from this Christmas any different than any other Christmas? You know? When all of a sudden our lives go back to normal, and we got all amped up for Christmas and everything else, and now it's the day after Christmas. Or will we be more like those parents? Will we be like the parents whose lives never again was the same because of the birth of Jesus Christ? I just wonder sometimes if we would look at things a different way. Mary and Joseph, they never returned from seeing Jesus. That very day, you know, that Christmas night when they first saw Jesus was for them only a beginning. Many of us at this season, guys, we draw near to God. And it's really hard for me to just say, boy, let it just be and go back. But it was only the beginning. And this Christmas could be the beginning of your everlasting life. I don't know. I'm just a messenger. And for them, it was just the beginning. From then on, every night for the rest of their lives, they were with Jesus Christ. Every night for the rest of their lives, they stood with Christ Jesus. They did. They had to leave Bethlehem, but they took Jesus with them. You know, many of us will have things that come along, and maybe we have to get up and go back to the old hustle and bustle. But the thing that I see is, boy, do you see what it is? Boy, to be able to, when you leave, take Jesus with you. You know? And we know, for instance, that they moved from Bethany to Bethlehem to Egypt. And then they moved from Egypt to Nazareth. But they never moved without taking Jesus with them. They never moved without taking Jesus with them, church. And there was one time when they did slip up. You know, we all have those times. But there was one time when they did slip up and they left Jesus behind in Jerusalem. And it's kind of funny, but as soon as they really realized that they were missing him, they immediately went back to find him. And guys, listen, it's the next day. And if you're missing that joy and that peace and that goodwill towards men as it was yesterday, man, what do you really hope is that, boy, they immediately, when we see that, we get back to Jesus as quickly as possible. And we find him. Millions of people will come and worship to see Jesus in this season. But the greatest majority of them simply leave saying, that's nice. And so it's just that way. That's nice. And they go on with their lives just as it was in any other day. And there'll only be a few having seen Jesus, determined to never leave his side again. And I don't know what the few is. God calls the few the numbers of the grains of the seashores. Or maybe the stars in the universe. I don't know what a few is. But I pray to God that a few get to hear what it is to go on and believe in Christmas every day of the year. We have to move. And whatever it takes, you know, when we move, make sure that you get back to your local churches. We've been hearing that in our Sunday schools, in our affirmation, in our hospitality ministries and everything else, guys. Listen, assemble in your local bodies. Assemble in your local churches. Get back to them. Yes, you got to move. And we use that. You know, Satan uses that as the greatest tool to deceive you and run you away from Christ. Take your Christmas away from you. But we need to make sure that as we move and if we go different places, that we get back to that local church where we can all keep Christ with us. That's what it's really about. And when we do on occasion get sidetracked or misplace our Lord in our lives, church, make a beeline back to him as soon as you figure it out. It's not too hard to figure out. If all of a sudden all we can think about is the things that miss God, the things that miss our mark, well, then it's obvious that we're not looking to what God provided. So get back to Him as quickly as possible. For Joseph and Mary, well, Christmas was one more than just once a year celebration, guys. It was a day-by-day reality. You know, Brother Mike and I had a little talk about that, and that's so true. You know, Christmas is every day. For Joseph and Mary, it was just, it wasn't a once-a-year thing. It was a celebration, and it was day-by-day because of the reality of Jesus Christ. You know, Mary and Joseph, well, they nurtured the life or their relationship with Christ just as well. Raising children is a growing experience. It really is. You know, anyone who's raised children knows the very truth of that. You grow up almost as much as the kid does. My goodness, I was one of the worst spellers there was, and all of a sudden I pounded it for my granddaughter, and you know what? She got to where she didn't miss a thing on them. You know, and even to this day, she's a great speller. But in that, I found out how to pronounce words. I found out how to, write them words, how to sound them out, what goes first, the I or the E, all those different things. And we grow, guys, we grow. And we grow as much as they did. For one thing, you hardly know your child that first day you bring him into your house, or that child, that girl. You don't know them at all, church. We really don't. You have to get to know that kid growing up in your house. You have to really get to know him. And the truth is, you never really know them fully. You really don't. And as they grow up, they change, and so do you, and so do I. And so our relationship requires some constant care. Brother Steve. It requires some constant care to make sure you really know them. My goodness, my granddaughter could fall off dead, if I didn't know that she was sick. You have to get to know them. And you have to learn how to be a parent. And that's one of the hardest things in the world, because you still want to be a kid at heart yourself. But you have to learn how to be a parent. And so I'm hoping that we're always improving in that area just as well. And while the shepherds returned to their flock, guys, Mary and Joseph stayed right there. And they were responsible for the rest of their lives to nurture and develop their relationship with Jesus Christ. They really are, and we are too. That very same truth is in our relationship with Christ. We got to get to know Him. We got to know a little more, and we learn a little more day by day than we did the very first day you were introduced to Him, our Lord and our Savior. And we are glad for the relationship. I just tell you, I can remember the day of my salvation just as if it was yesterday. And I can't tell you how much greater feeling there was, knowing that all those hard things that I was doing to be such a good person really absolutely wasn't what God required of me at all. It was really to nurture and to know His Son. And I'm glad for that relationship. And there, every one of us is glad of that relationship. And in that relationship, we get to know that we're not just going to pass from here to there with uncertainty. We're going straight to heaven. That's a wonderful thing. It's a great thing. But we hardly know Christ, really, and we almost know nothing about how to live pleasing to Him. Even after you got a little bit figured out, guys, we never really in this life obtain a place where we know how and what our relationship should be to Jesus Christ. We really do. There are many Christians who will tell you the truth, and I started to bring this up early in our introduction. There's a lot of Christians that will tell you the truth. And they can't, and I can't find no fault except for this one thing. They aren't growing in Christ anymore. You guys, Christ is an everyday thing. Christ is an all year long thing. Christ come to, you know, bring good tidings, you know, to everyone. If we ain't growing, then there's certainly about Christ that, you know, they are happy with what they know. That's the other thing. That's the sad thing is we're happy to know Christ. We're happy to have a knowledge of him, but we ain't going any further. You know, they're not interested in knowing anything more. Well, I got Jesus. That's enough. I got baptized. I'm good. I don't need to go to church. I don't need to do the ordinances of God. But Mary and Joseph, not only Christmas, but the rest of their lives, they grew in their relationship with Jesus Christ. Boy, church, it's a heck of a challenge. It really is. And Mary kept all that Jesus said and all that was said about Jesus in her heart. Luke 2:19 says, and Mary kept these things and pondered them in her heart. Later in Luke chapter 2, verse 51, it says, and he went down with them, and he came to Nazareth, and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all these things in her heart. The one verse Mary kept that was all said about Jesus Christ in her heart, she pondered on them. Church, I've asked you time and time again, the Spirit has asked you not to hear this man standing behind the podium, but really hear what Jesus has to say. You know, and she heard, and she pondered them in her heart. And the other things that she held and kept them that Jesus might have even said to her, she kept his words in her heart. And I hope that we can see the significance of it. You know, don't just believe Jesus died for you for a brief moment and then pack up and go home. You know, he's here every day. And when they went back home, Mary and Joseph took all that was said and all that was done about Jesus, and by Jesus, they kept them. And they pondered them right there in their hearts. And they were changed forever by the words that were spoken by Jesus Christ and the words that were spoken about Jesus Christ. And this is no different for us. Christmas, it's the next day. We were excited and we were filled with great gratitude towards God. But I wonder if we really did get an opportunity to come and see Jesus. I wonder if we really did have that spirit of what God called Christmas. For me, Christmas is the day he got saved. That's the first day I met Jesus Christ. And then it becomes that great big job that we have, that Mary and Joseph had, as you know, we have to nurture that Jesus, church. Viewers, you have to nurture it, and to nurture it means, my goodness, if you got houseplants, you know if you don't nurture them, they're going to die. My goodness, if you have animals and don't nurture them, they're going to die. If you have children and you ain't feeding them and you're not doing anything with them, guys, they're definitely going to die. And so in a practical sense, just because the day is past, don't let that slip from you, because it's your job, it's your requirement by God himself to nurture that relationship. Keep it alive. So here we are this Christmas. And I wonder what kind of crowd that we all become. You know, are we like the shepherds and the wise men that came to see Jesus, but they returned to their own lives? Or are we like Mary and Joseph, for whom Christmas was only the beginning of a radical new way in their life? It is a hard change, guys. You have to really change your mind. God calls every one of us to repentance. And he commands every one of us to confess Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And it's a radical change in your life. It's very hard. You have to live it by faith, not the things seen, but what God has already promised. You know, it's a radical change. And not only is it a radical change in our life, but it changes our thought process. If God be for you, then who can be against you? Or there is the other side that spoke out of Proverbs where a way of man he thinks is right, but at its end, it's death. The only way we can be set assured is if our Christmas for the next day and the next day and the next day is found in nurturing Christ Jesus in our lives. You know, that radical new life and that radical new thought, who never left Jesus, who never stopped seeing Jesus, who nurtured their relationship with him, and who kept it all that was said about him and all that was said, you know, from him. But I wish that you would ponder these things in your heart. And I wish that your Christmas could go on for eternity, as God really wills for our lives. Now, it is the next day after Christmas, and it's only by, you know, the divine intervention of the Spirit that worked out that way. But what are we going to do? Are we going to get up and live the same thing we've been living for the rest of our lives prior? Or are we really going to take this Christmas and make it something special? Jesus is coming, church. Jesus is coming, viewers. And when he comes, he's coming for his body. And he's coming not for a scattered body, but he's coming for an assembled body. And the only way you can keep it assembled is to keep it nurtured in him. And keep the edification of those around you, to keep you coming together to be able to bring forth that message of the forgiveness of sin. Christmas is an everyday thing. We are more than spokespersons on God's behalf through faith in Jesus Christ. This Christmas, I pray that we continue on and that, boy, we really do see that it is our job. But how do I nurture it? How do I keep it going? How does this go? Well, first thing is to hear him call you and to know that if you're outside of that, if you're not with a local body, if you're not nurturing Jesus Christ or the Word of God in your life, that you would be so challenged and encouraged to get that going again. And before you know it, you'd find out that, boy, the joy and the goodwill towards men will last all throughout the whole year. It'll be something that really is a radical change. We all like changes, you know, but this is one that never changes. This is one that is always the same, and he's concrete, as solid foundation as it can be. And all he wants and all he's crying forth, even this second day, the day after Christmas, is that we'd all come and admire God's work in that little bitty baby, Jesus Christ. It started with a little bitty baby of Jesus Christ in my heart too. And it starts the same way in your hearts. And all of a sudden that baby starts growing up. And as that baby grows up, you hear it yearning and it yearns more and more for the Spirit of God to speak through it. And when all of a sudden that manifests so much that you can't do nothing but it steps out on faith and it starts sharing the message of Jesus Christ with everybody. And then that life turns into everlasting life. I see it setting before me this day. It turns into life everlasting that I can be assured that God didn't lie to me. That what I believed in the beginning of my Christmas, that it'll be that day, way, the day that I'm gone. And for anyone that's viewing, don't let this Christmas be just another Christmas. Let it be that God has spoke to your hearts and to your souls. And let it be that God has called from his own words, that you wouldn't have to stand outside of him any longer, but you could really be gathered unto him. That's all God has wanted from the beginning, world. He just wants you saved. And he's went to great means of this provision of a Savior so that we could get there. And you can't mess it up because He got it all in his son, Jesus Christ. He was that perfect sacrifice. And he gathered all that into that very vessel, that flesh. And God punished flesh once and for all of humanity. It's not some special deal for those that are chosen. It's actually for even the Gentile world. Jesus come for the Gentile world. I didn't come for the righteous, but I came from the unrighteous. You know, those that really know that they're without God in their lives. And those that really know that when the Spirit speaks to them, I don't know who you are. But when that Spirit touches your heart, it's to bounce an action out of you. And it either draws you near God through Jesus Christ, or it drives you away from God. But even in it, it's a clear direction of whether you receive the gift God provided, or if you just let it go the next day. I'm here to say that, boy, guys, every one of you start with a little bitty baby. But it's our job to nurture that, and it's our job to assemble in local bodies. And it's our job because God had placed us where it pleased Him, not where it pleased you. And a little bit of an inconvenience driving all the way from Toledo to here. Brother Mike won't miss it for a minute. He gets down here. Why? Because he knows Jesus is here. And he enjoys it. You know, we're not very masterful. We just carry the message of forgiveness of sins for all of humanity. This Christmas, church, it's the next day. And it's the next day. And it's the next day. Today is the day of salvation.
Amen.
Today. You know, my goodness, if you're hearing this, I just ask every one of you that, boy, you would just confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior. If you're outside and you don't know Him, boy, call upon Him. And God will take that and He'll hear that. And when you hear that, it comes up out of that soul. What must I do to be saved? Repent, believe, and be baptized, every one of you, for the removal of what separated you from God in the first place, your sin. And that I might give you, not a gift for one day, but I might give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that secures you for eternity. You know, get up, call upon Him, live it. Live it this day, the next day, and the next day. But you got to come to Jesus. And you got to hear the call of God calling you. Don't let this just be another year. Let it really be a calling from God Himself. Guys, if you're here today and you haven't confessed Jesus as Lord and Savior, if you haven't been baptized in Him, it's an opportunity that God gives every week after every message. And He gives you an opportunity to call upon Him to be saved, every one of you. And if you hear His voice and you're far away or you can't get here, my goodness, get to a local church. Our brother Steve just so masterfully keeps telling us, we're not here to draw people out of their churches. My God, we're only here to encourage you in your churches.
Amen.
You know, I don't know about, you know, different denominations. All I know about is Jesus Christ and Him crucified for the sins of humanity. Well, I just know. So get to your local churches. Call upon the Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't know, ask God. He says, any of you that lack wisdom, ask and it shall be received. So if you're here and you're hearing, guys, follow Jesus. Continue to look to Him. Never sway left or right, because He's the only way into the kingdom of God. My favorite verse, I am the way, the truth, and the life. You know, I love another thing that my wife has shared several times with people that are getting ready to pass on. When you see Jesus, grab His hand. If you see Jesus today, my goodness, grab His hand, because He'll lead you straight into heaven. Church, I love you. God loves you. In Jesus Christ's name, let's stand together, please.
What verse is that in?
John 14:6.
Thank you.
The way, the truth, and the light.
Thank you.
All right. We're going to sing, Oh,
know how we love Jesus, and we'll know because what we share with others. Man, guys, take that little bitty baby and literally share that with every person that you come in contact with, encouraging them more to follow Jesus, follow him all the way to the kingdom of God. If you're here today, all I can say is God's loved you. And it is the next day and the next day that really matters. Let us go to the Father, please. Father, we just come to you at this time, Lord. And though it be the day after Christmas, Lord, let us not ever lose sight of what you really did right there in that manger. Father, you gave that birth to that little bitty baby, Father, that boy needs nurtured and it needs to grow up so that we really know him. And boy, Father, as we go forth, I just ask that we'd let the others that are around us have the knowledge that you've gave to us this day. Father, I thank you so much for the message of your forgiveness of sin that, well, I don't want anybody to pass out of here without it. Father, as we go forth this week, encourage one another with your words and your prayers. Edify one another with the Spirit, Lord. Boy, Father, bring us back and assemble us here as you see fit. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Love you all.